We will start with the gluteal region and then continue. Now, the gluteal region is the region of the buttock, which is actually lying below the iliac crest. So this is your iliac crest. There are several important structures in the gluteal region. As you can see here, there are muscles, there are ligaments, and there are vessels and nerves, neurovascular structures. Now, of all the structures, this structure, the piriformis muscle, has a major role there, because that is an important landmark. This muscle is an important landmark in the gluteal region. Now, there are structures, especially the neurovascular structures, some structures enter the gluteal region above the superior border of the piriformis muscle, as you can see here. And some neurovascular structures, vessels and nerves, enter the gluteal region below the lower border of the piriformis muscle. So for that reason, that muscle becomes important if you are going to learn these neurovascular structures that are entering the gluteal region. Then you can't see the piriformis muscle before you dissect this area and reflect the gluteal muscles, mainly the gluteus maximus muscle, which is a large muscle covering the piriformis muscle and several other small muscles in that area. Now, in this particular specimen of the diagram, the piriformis, the gluteus maximus muscle has been cut and reflected, as you can see here. Okay, it has been cut and reflected. So this is one end of the muscle, this is the other end of the muscle. So once you reflect the gluteus maximus muscle, you can see these piriformis muscle, and below that you get several other muscles like the obturator internus muscle and the gamelli, superior and inferior gamelli muscles, and the quadratus femoris muscle. So when you do the practical, either online or on site, you will see all these muscles in specimens. Then slightly above and under the gluteus maximus muscle, there are two other muscles, gluteus medius and gluteus minimus muscles. Gluteus medius and gluteus minimus muscles. Now all these muscles belong to the group of gluteal muscles of the gluteal region. Now when you concentrate on the neurovascular structures, you can see superior gluteal vessels. It says artery here, there's a vein also. You can call it in general superior gluteal vessels, and the superior gluteal nerve enters the gluteal region above the superior border of the piriformis muscle, as I said before. Then below the inferior border of the piriformis muscle, again you have inferior gluteal vessels and the inferior gluteal nerve. And then there are two other nerves, the posterior cutaneous nerve of the thigh and the sciatic nerve. Now the sciatic nerve is the most important structure that you can find in this area. That is the largest nerve that you can find in the body. And that nerve supplies all the compartments of the thigh, leg, and the dorsum and the sole of the foot, except the anterior compartment of the thigh, anterior and medial compartment of the thigh. All the other compartments of the thigh and the leg and the foot are supplied by the sciatic nerve. So it is an important, it's highly important nerve that is found in this area. Then when it comes to the superior gluteal nerve and the inferior gluteal nerve, remember this, the inferior gluteal nerve supplies the gluteus maximus muscle. So gluteus maximus is supplied by the inferior gluteal nerve. The superior gluteal nerve, this one, supplies the gluteus medius and gluteus minimus muscles. Gluteus minimus muscle, gluteus medius muscle, and there's another muscle called tensor fascia lata muscle. So all these three muscles, gluteus medius, minimus, and tensor fascia lata muscle, all three muscles, 1, 2, and 3, all these three muscles are supplied by the superior gluteal nerve. Now these three muscles, 1, 2, and 3, gluteus medius, minimus, and tensor fascia lata, three muscles together, they are called hip abductors. They abduct the hip joint. There are hip adductors separately. If you grow the thigh like this, and if this is the anterior compartment, you get a medial compartment or adductor compartment on the medial aspect of the thigh, and those are the adductors of the hip. Compartment of the thigh, there are separate group of muscles that can adduct the hip joint. So these three muscles, my point was these three muscles, gluteus medius, minimus and tensor fascia lata muscle, they are hip abductors supplied by the superior gluteal nerve. Remember that point. Then, now if when you studied the bones of the lower limb, if you have studied the pelvis also, or the hip bone, together with the bones of the lower limb, you must have seen that there are two notches called greater sciatic notch and the lesser sciatic notch on the hip bone. So this is the greater sciatic notch and this is the lesser sciatic notch. And when the pelvis is formed by the two hip bones on either side and the sacrum, two hip bones on either side and the sacrum behind, when the pelvis is formed, there are several ligaments involved. Two important ligaments are the sacrospinous ligament, one in green, and the sacrotuberous ligament, one in orange color. Because of these two ligaments in that area, the two the foramina, greater sciatic for the two notches, greater sciatic notch and the lesser sciatic notch, are converted into two foramina, the greater sciatic foramen and the lesser sciatic foramen, which you can see here. Okay, so the notch is converted into a foramen. Now these structures that we just went through, the neurovascular structures, the superior gluteal vessels and nerve, inferior gluteal vessels and nerve, the sciatic nerve and the posterior cutaneous nerve of the thigh, all these actually they enter the gluteal region through the greater sciatic foramen. The piriformis also enters the gluteal region through the greater sciatic foramen like this. From the piriformis muscle is actually the proximal attachment is to the middle three pieces of the sacrum here. Then it passes through the greater sciatic foramen to enter the gluteal region. Now above that you get the superior gluteal vessels and nerve, and below that you get the inferior gluteal nerve and vessels and the sciatic nerve and the posterior cutaneous nerve of the thigh. So that's an important thing you need to remember. Then there is another point. There are certain other structures that were not listed out here in this diagram. Those are these three structures. Again, they are neurovascular structures, two nerves and one vessel in the sense, you know, it's an artery and a vein. They also enter the gluteal region through the greater sciatic foramen here, but they don't stay there. They disappear again by re-entering the lesser sciatic foramen. Okay, so it's like this. So they enter the gluteal region through the greater sciatic foramen and leaves the gluteal region through the lesser sciatic foramen to enter this area. Now it's like this. Now when you do the pelvic region and the perineum later, not now, in your last semester, you will learn that there is what is called a pelvic diaphragm. It's a muscular diaphragm forming a structure like this, pelvic diaphragm. Above that you get the pelvic cavity, and below that you get the perineal region. Now these three structures that enter the gluteal region and disappear by entering the lesser sciatic foramen, they actually enter the perineum. They leave the pelvic cavity here, enter the gluteal region, then enter the perineum. Okay, so that you will learn later. Now the three structures, what are these three structures? They are the nerve to obturator internus, internal pudendal artery and vein, you can call it internal pudendal vessels, and the pudendal nerve. Now the pudendal nerve is the nerve of the perineal area. You will learn later, you don't have to learn it now. And later you will see that branches of the pudendal nerve and the internal pudendal artery and the vein, they actually are found in certain areas of the perineum called pudendal canal and deep perineal pouch. All these things you will learn later. Now for the moment, what you need to remember is that other than these superior gluteal vessels nerve, inferior gluteal vessels nerves, and the sciatic nerve, there are a few other structures somewhere here, deep to these muscles. They enter the gluteal region for a short while and then leave the gluteal region to enter the perineum. And those are these three structures: nerve to obturator internus, internal pudendal vessels, and the pudendal nerve. That's all you need to remember now. Then the sciatic nerve, I said it is the largest nerve in the body, and it supplies most of the lower limb except for the anterior and medial compartments of the thigh, and sometimes you have to give injections to the region of the buttock, which are called intramuscular injections. They are given into the muscles. When there's a large volume, you have to give, you choose the area of the buttock, because other muscles like the deltoid muscle, which is very frequently used, is too small for those large volume injections. So you go for gluteal muscles, because you have a large bulk of muscles there, gluteus maximus, medius, and minimus muscles. So you select that area, but with the risk of having an important nerve in that area, which you can damage by these injections. So when you give injections, you have to give these injections as far away as possible from the sciatic nerve. Now, for that reason, you should have an idea about the course of the sciatic nerve in that area. Course of the sciatic nerve in that area. So for that reason, you need to have an idea about how you draw the sciatic nerve. That is what is called surface marking. Now, for you to surface mark the sciatic nerve, which is sometimes tested in exams also, you need three bony points: the posterior superior iliac spine on the hip bone, then the ischial tuberosity. If you are sitting now, you are sitting on your ischial tuberosities. Okay. And then the superior surface of the greater trochanter. So this is the superior surface of the greater trochanter. Now, these three bony points, if you have these three bony points, then you can actually surface mark the sciatic nerve. Now, this is how you do it. You draw a line between the posterior superior iliac spine and the ischial tuberosity, and the point at the junction between the upper third and the lower two thirds of that line, the point which lies at the junction between the upper one third and the lower two thirds of that line, which you can see here, that is the point where the sciatic nerve enters the gluteal region through the greater sciatic foramen. Okay, so that is the entering point. So you can put it as a dot. Then, if you draw a line between the ischial tuberosity and the superior surface of the greater trochanter, and you get the midpoint between those two bony points, midpoint, then that is the point at which the sciatic nerve becomes vertical and go vertically down. Okay, so between these two points, 1 and 2, its course is curved laterally. It's a laterally curved course. So you can draw a laterally curved line if you are going to draw it. Then from point 2, it moves vertically down. So you can draw a line vertically down on the thigh. And there is another way to do it. You can take the midpoint between the two femoral condyles, midpoint, and join this number 2 point to the number 3 point, midpoint between the two femoral condyles. And then that becomes the surface marking of the nerve. Let me repeat it, so that you will get a clear idea about it. So this is how you do it. You identify these three bony points: posterior superior iliac spine, ischial tuberosity, and the superior surface of the greater trochanter. Then you draw a line between the posterior superior iliac spine and the ischial tuberosity, and take the point that lies between the upper one third and the lower two thirds of the line joining the posterior superior iliac spine and ischial tuberosity. And that is the emerging point of the sciatic nerve, is that point. Then you take the midpoint between the ischial tuberosity and the superior surface of the greater trochanter, which is this one, and you join these two lines with a curved, you join these two points with a curved line. The curvature is, it's a laterally curved line. Then from this second point, you draw a line vertically down on the back of the thigh. Okay, so that becomes the surface marking of the sciatic nerve. So if you don't draw a vertical line, you can have an alternative way. You take the midpoint between the two femoral condyles, and join this second point to the third point like this. So that becomes the sciatic nerve. But you have to remember one point. The sciatic nerve divides before it reaches the knee joint area. Okay. Now there is a region called popliteal fossa here. At the apex of the popliteal fossa, the sciatic nerve divides into a laterally placed common peroneal nerve and a medially placed tibial nerve. So when you draw the nerve, you have to remember that it divides before it reaches the knee joint area, okay, at the apex of the popliteal fossa, because if you are drawing it on a person, you will not see the popliteal fossa, okay. So you can only draw it up to, say, hand's breadth above the knee joint, like, okay. So if you put your hand here, it's about hand's breadth above the knee joint line. So this is the point, okay. So if someone asks you to surface mark the sciatic nerve, or describe how the sciatic nerve is surface marked or drawn, this is how you describe it. Then this concept of intramuscular injections to the buttock, which I mentioned before, if you divide the buttock into four quadrants, like in this one diagram, you divide the buttock into four quadrants like this, then the safe area for intramuscular injections is the upper outer quadrant. It is the upper outer quadrant. Now this is upper inner quadrant or upper medial quadrant, lower medial or lower inner quadrant, lower lateral or lower outer quadrant. So this is called upper lateral or upper outer quadrant. So that quadrant is the safe area for intramuscular injections. As you can see here, that injection is well away from the sciatic nerve. Okay, so these two quadrants are totally out. Okay, so this one is also not taken because you get the superior gluteal vessels and nerves in that quadrant. Okay, so then other issue here is, now supposing that this is a patient. Okay, this is the buttock region of the patient. Now to draw these quadrants on the buttock of the patient, you have to expose the whole area of the patient like this. Okay, so if you are not going to do it on both sides, at least you will have to expose only one side, which is practically a little bit embarrassing for the patient. Okay, because patients will not like themselves to be exposed like that. So it's good if you can expose them minimally and give the injection. Anyway, you are going to give the injection to that area. Okay, so no point in exposing this area and making them more embarrassed. So what you do is, you use a separate procedure where you can get at this point, get at this region. So what you do is, you take a measurement like this. Now you cover the patient, the rest of this area is covered with clothes. Okay, so you expose the lateral area like this, and you find the anterior superior iliac spine and the tubercle of the iliac crest, and the anterior superior iliac spine. And you spread the fingers of your hand, like in this diagram. So if you are a right-handed person, you use your left hand and spread the fingers of your left hand, and keep the tip of the index finger of the left hand on the anterior superior iliac spine, and keep the tip of the middle finger on the tubercle of the iliac crest. Then the area between the two fingers is the safe area for injection. So that is actually a small area in the upper outer quadrant of the buttock. So you need not expose the rest of the buttock if you take the measurement like this. So you clean this area with alcohol or spirit, then you give the injection to that area with your right hand. Now your right hand is free. So that's the best way to give intramuscular injections to the buttock area, and the injection will actually go into the medial and the gluteus medius and minimus muscles. And the sciatic nerve and even the superior gluteal nerve and vessels, they are spared. Okay, they are not damaged because of this procedure. So remember this. Then a few points about the branches of the sciatic nerve. I said that is a very large nerve, and I also said that it divides into its two branches, main branches, the tibial nerve and the common peroneal nerve at the apex of the popliteal fossae. The popliteal fossa is like this. Okay, the nerve enters the popliteal fossa, and immediately after that it divides into its tibial and common peroneal branches. So this is the lateral side. So this is the common peroneal nerve, and this is the tibial nerve. That's how it divides. Okay, and then this tibial nerve is the nerve that supplies the posterior compartment of the leg, which you will learn later, and the sole of the foot. Sole of the foot, muscles in the sole of the foot. Then the common peroneal nerve, on the other hand, divides into two further branches, the superficial peroneal nerve and the deep peroneal nerve. Superficial peroneal nerve supplies the lateral or the peroneal compartment of the leg. Deep peroneal nerve supplies the anterior compartment and then continues down to supply the muscles of the dorsum of the foot. Okay, muscles of the dorsum of the foot. So if you again, you know, go to the main nerve, the sciatic nerve, all these areas are therefore supplied by the branches of the sciatic nerve. Okay. Then there is a new concept that I want to talk about, the Trendelenburg sign and Trendelenburg gait. They are the same, only a slight difference is there. Now in a normal person, or this is a normal person, in a normal person, as you can see here, when the person lifts, now in a normal person, you know, first you say, you take the two limbs, if the two limbs are like this in a normal person on the ground, then their center of gravity lies between the two limbs, lower limbs. Center of gravity lies in between the two lower limbs. Okay, that's how they stand straight without falling. Now, as you can see in the first diagram, when the person lifts, say the person, if you ask the person to lift one foot, as in this case, here it's the right foot that has been lifted from the ground. The moment you lift the right foot, what happens is, now the center of gravity was here in the middle. When this foot is lifted, the person tends to fall to the side where the foot was lifted, non-weight bearing side. Okay, non-weight bearing side, person tends to fall. To prevent that, in a normal person, what happens is, now we talked about the hip abductors, gluteus medius, minimus, and tensor fascia lata muscles. These muscles contract on the weight bearing side, in this case is the left side. When the right foot is elevated, hip abductors on the left side, weight bearing side, will contract, and the hip joint gets abducted. Now when the limb is on the ground, which is fixed now, when the abductors contract, rather than the thigh moving, the pelvis moves now. Okay, what happens is the pelvis is tilted like that, because of pulling towards that side. So the non-weight bearing side, that is the right side where the foot was lifted, the pelvis, the iliac crest is lifted up because of the contraction of the weight bearing side abductors, which are normal in this case. Then what happens is, the moment you do that, the center of gravity now falls through this weight bearing limb. So the person is stable now. Now, what if these abductors on the left side are paralyzed? If these abductors are paralyzed, what will happen when the person lifts the foot from the ground, right foot? Now, instead of the pelvis moving up, it moves down now. It moves down. And when it moves down, then the center of gravity remains on the right side of the left foot, weight bearing side, and the person tends to fall to that side. Now, to prevent that falling, Then the trunk, even though it's not clear, the trunk bends to the weight bearing side. Okay, so the trunk was like this before. Now the trunk is like this, bent to the opposite side, and the center of gravity again, when this moves to that side, center of gravity again falls through the weight bearing limb. And again, the person will not fall because of that. But remember, the pelvis has tilted to the non-weight bearing side now. Okay, so the moment this happens, when the pelvis, the non-weight bearing side, pelvis it drops down, that is called positive Trendelenburg sign. It is positive Trendelenburg sign. Okay, so if you ask the patient to lift the right foot and the pelvis, the iliac crest or the pelvis, the upper border of the pelvis drops on that side, then that is positive Trendelenburg sign on the right. Okay, right side, positive Trendelenburg sign. Okay, then when such a person walks, his trunk tends to move sideways because of, you know, to maintain the center of gravity. So then that can give rise to waddling gait, like a duck, okay, moving from side to side. That happens especially if you have bilateral paralysis. If both sides, the hip abductors are paralyzed, then every time he lifts, either it moves this way or that way. Otherwise, you know, this movement will be limited here. Okay, when he lifts the left foot, then there is not much movement to that side. It will be in the center. Only when he lifts the right foot, it will move to the other side to maintain the center of gravity. I think you can understand this point. So then when you walk, what you get is Trendelenburg gait. Okay. When you test it, you know, just by, you know, asking the person to lift one foot, that is Trendelenburg side. Okay. If it is positive, if it drops on that side. Okay. Then a few things about the hip or the hip joint, that area. Now, the first thing you need to remember is that the hip joint, when it comes to the pelvis, which is like this, pelvis is formed by the sacrum at the back and the two hip bones on either side. And this each hip bone is also called os innominatum. Okay, the whole thing is the pelvis, and one bone is called the hip bone. Okay. And each hip bone is formed by three bones, ilium, pubis, and the ischium, united by a cartilage. It's called triradiate cartilage. It's a Y-shaped cartilage. And at the point where these three bones fuse by the triradiate cartilage, there is a cup-shaped cavity, which is called acetabulum. And that is the contribution by the hip bone to form the hip joint, which is a ball and socket type of synovial joint. So acetabulum is on one side, contributing to form the joint. Then the other end is the head of the femur. Okay, it is the head of the femur, which is on the proximal end of the femur. Then hip joint is, you know, it's like the shoulder joint. Hip joint also can do all the possible movements. It can flex, it can extend, it can abduct, it can adduct, it can circumduct to some extent, and it can undergo external and internal rotation, or medial or lateral rotation. All these movements are possible in the hip joint. Now, other movements are not a problem, but when it comes to rotation, internal and external rotation, or medial and lateral rotation of the hip joint or the femur at the hip joint, then there is an issue. Now, the axis of rotation, now when it comes to the humerus, for instance, the rotation, the axis passes through the long axis of the bone. Here, the axis of rotation, it's a vertical axis that passes through the center of the head here, and the midpoint between the two femoral condyles here. Okay, but because of the length of the neck and the angle between the neck and the shaft of the bone, because of that, when there is medial rotation, the greater trochanter and the neck moves forward. The greater trochanter and the neck moves forward. When there is lateral rotation, the two same structure, the greater trochanter and the neck moves backwards. Okay, so it's forward and backward movement in that area during medial and lateral rotation. So the point to remember here is that if there are muscles attached to the greater trochanter and the proximal end of the femur from front like this, when they contract, this end will move forward and that will medially rotate the femur. And if there are muscles attached at the back here to the greater trochanter and the proximal end of the femur, when they contract, they will move the greater trochanter and the neck backwards and they will laterally rotate the femur. So remember that point. Then few things about ligaments of the hip joint. Now hip joint is a fairly mobile joint. It's only less mobile than the shoulder joint, but its mobility is high compared to many other joints. Now there are ligaments in the hip joint which stabilizes the joint, even though the bony factors are the main factors that stabilize the joint, because it's a well fitting ball and socket joint, unlike the shoulder joint. Ligaments do play a role in stabilizing after the bony factors. Now the first ligament is the iliofemoral ligament. Iliofemoral ligament, which is an inverted Y-shaped ligament. So if I draw the inverted Y, it is like this. Okay, so this is the iliofemoral ligament. Now it prevents overextension of the hip joint. And if you take the Y, the base of the Y, which is this one, base of the Y is attached to the anterior inferior iliac spine. Okay, it's anterior inferior iliac spine. And the two limbs of the Y, is attached to the intertrochanteric line. So this is called intertrochanteric line. Then the second ligament is pubofemoral ligament, which is a triangular shaped ligament. The base is attached to the superior pubic ramus. Apex is again attached to the intertrochanteric line, like the iliofemoral ligament. That also prevents overextension of the hip joint. Then there is a third ligament, which is called ischiofemoral ligament, attached between the body of the ischium, so this area, to the greater trochanter, somewhere here, greater trochanter, which also prevents overextension. Okay. And there are two other ligaments that is in relation to the hip joint, which is called the transverse acetabular ligament, which if this is the acetabulum, there is an acetabular notch here. Okay, so there is a gap in the acetabulum. That gap is filled by the transverse acetabular ligament. And the ligamentum teres is a ligament that attaches the head of the femur to the acetabulum here. It's not only attached the head of the femur to the acetabulum, it's attached to the head of the femur to the acetabulum as well as the transverse acetabular ligament. Okay, so both areas it is attached and keeps the head in position, and through that it gets some sort of blood supply in childhood, which you will learn later. Then a few important relationships of the hip joint. Now hip joint lies behind this area. I think you will not be able to identify this area. Now this is your abdomen. Okay, so this is your abdomen and this is your lower lip. Okay, so this is your perineal area, your genitalia and all here. So your abdomen, your umbilicus somewhere here, not so below, your umbilicus is somewhere here. Okay, so this is your lower limb and this is the anterior aspect of the lower limb, which you will learn in a while. Then in the anterior aspect of the thigh, you see three structures. This is the femoral vein, this is femoral artery, and this is the femoral nerve. Now the femoral vein, artery, and nerve are separated from the hip joint, the capsule of the hip joint, by three muscles: the pectineus muscle, the psoas muscle underneath this, and the iliacus muscle. So if the iliacus muscle is like this, psoas muscle like this, and the pectineus muscle is like this. You get the femoral vein, artery, and the nerve. Vein, artery, and the nerve. Superficial to the three muscles, pectineus muscle here, then psoas muscle, then iliacus muscle. So underneath this, you get the capsule of the joint. So that's what I mentioned. Then other than that, there is a bursa here. You must have learned about bursae. There's a bursa filled with synovial fluid between the iliopsoas, iliacus and the psoas muscles, and the joint capsule underneath to reduce friction. That's a different issue. Okay, but just remember this point, which you will revisit when you do the anterior compartment of the thigh. So this is the point that I raised. Then superiorly, you can see the hip joint here, acetabulum. Superior to the acetabulum or the hip joint, anteriorly, anterosuperiorly rather, you get the rectus femoris muscle. So this is rectus femoris muscle. Sorry, the arrow indicates the rectus femoris muscle, this one. Then superiorly you get the gluteus minimus muscle. So this is gluteus minimus muscle. Okay, you don't have to remember all this, but you know, just get an idea about it. Then inferiorly you get the obturator externus muscle. All these things you will learn later. Then behind you get the piriformis muscle that we studied some time ago, piriformis muscle and the gamelli muscles. So this is the piriformis tendon, then the superior and inferior gamelli muscles lying posterior. Okay, then this is the sciatic nerve indicated by this arrow, sciatic nerve. Sciatic nerve gets separated from the joint by having the gamelli muscles in between. Okay, I don't know whether you can grasp it. Then laterally, now if this is the hip joint laterally, it there is an ilio structure, tough band called iliotibial tract attached to the iliac crest here, and the tibial condyle, lateral tibial condyle like this. So that lies lateral to the hip joint here. Okay, then deep here you get the pelvic cavity. Deep you get the pelvic cavity, which is shown here. Okay, and the structures here are the ovary here and the obturator vessels, as you can see here. Here you get these are obturator nerve and vessels. Ovary lies somewhere here in the pelvic cavity, which is actually a deep or medial relation of the hip joint. Okay, so outside this, on outside here, you get the hip joint somewhere here. Okay, so for some reason, if there's a fracture in the acetabulum due to a fall or something, and the head of the femur is driven into the pelvic cavity by fracturing the lateral wall of the pelvic cavity here, fracturing here, that can damage this obturator vessels, nerve, and the ovary in that area. Okay, so that is the area of the ovary.